With me in the studio this morning from Bezant Resources, I'm joined by Laurence Read. Laurence, morning.
Hey, how you doing, Andrew?
Always good to see you. Good, very well, thank you. Look, Bezant Resources itself, been a little bit quiet this year from you, but I know you, a lot going on in the background, new strategy, new focus?
Yeah, no, completely. I mean, at the beginning of the year, we made lots of changes. We announced that we're probably going to we were going to completely focus on copper, big copper bowls. So Colin Berg came into the company, supported what we were trying to do. So we divested the Choco Platinum assets, received funds for that, got rid of all the liabilities. And we have two good copper projects. We have the Mankayan project, which is, they're at the opposite ends of the spectrum. One is a massive copper coal porphyry, 250,000 tons, etc., with a JORC resource established on it, an awful lot of work done it. The other is Eureka in Argentina, which has had not a lot of work done it, but is a sort of brownfields exploration site, which we'll talk about in a second. But if we did work on it, we'd be looking at near-term, smaller production, but looking at high-grade areas below what's in the past been mined by previous companies and been looked at by previous companies.
But as far as Mankayan's concerned in the Philippines, you've kicked off a new mining study here, have you?
Yeah, what we found is we had a period of basically going back into all the data of both projects and bringing in consultant mining engineers and consultant geologists and going through everything we found. And the more that we found, we did a lot of things. We understood a lot more. We began to look at the projects in a very different way. And for Bezant, probably one of the best moments of the year was when we came to meet with Mining Plus, who are an internationally recognized group, a major mining consultancy group who have done work on the project before, and said, we've been looking at all the work that's been done, and we've been looking at the lift one of the block cave. The block cave is basically, it's massive, it's high capex, it's sustainable, good, robust, long-term opex, but in short, you need $1 billion to put in. It's a great project, it's a great big project at 20 million tonnes per annum, 21% IRR, but it is big money. And we want to look at, we're talking to people, we've listened to people over the last year about how we move this project forward. But that type of money is for one particular, it's for a major company. So we're talking to groups, but that type of capex for a major company. What we found is by looking at Mankayan really closely is actually not a lot of work had been done on the grade differential. So that lovely high grade core we've got in the center, and also gaps that we're identifying in the drilling where we think high grade may occur. We went into Mining Plus and we said, well, what about this? And they said, well, that's what we think as well. So after quite a lot of work, it's not exciting work, you know, we've been doing lots of work like this and doing lots of community relations work, because you can't just walk back into a project and say we're back. We've announced this study, and what we're looking at fundamentally is looking at an alternate mining method to the lift one scenario. So the upper part of the block cave, which potentially might allow us or another company to get into the gold and the copper quickly at significantly less capex. And I have a figure in mind, which I'm not going to share with you. You might take a bite on the opex, but we've got great grade at Mankayan. I think it sits very comparably to other projects in the world, especially as grade depletes for copper. And you know, it's the days when it was one or even just a bit below that have probably gone. We've got highly attractive grade, but we need to be finding new ways, new approaches to how we do Mankayan. And we need work. We need to be doing sensible work to move this project on in a cost-effective way.
Typically, how long would a study like this take to complete?
We've scheduled it for Q1 completion of next year. So, underway. We're just going to be working away on that. And in terms of Mankayan, that's going to be the priority, is to wait until that comes out.
We brushed over some of those details a moment ago, but just remind us, so what's the resource, what kind of grades are at this project. What do you like about it?
Certainly, well, if we put up a graphic quickly, I mean, you can see the equivalent grade that we've got up in the graphic. What we did is we're starting to have a look at this project in, what's the reality of the project in context to everyone else in terms of a baseline? So not just looking at the inferred and indicated, but looking at the copper equivalents. And if you have a look at a quarter of a billion tonnes, it's not a massive, massive copper gold porphyry. It's not a billion tonnes of copper gold porphyry, but it's a lot of metal. It's a long mine life, and it's not a metal. It's just not a gargantuan copper gold porphyry. So if you look at the equivalent grade, if you look at the mineral grade, it sits up, as in one of the diagrams that we have here, very well in terms of that gold credit in there, in comparison to the copper. And we think that's what's really attractive about this project. It's genuinely sustainable. It generally has the legs to be a long-term economic project. And it could probably wear a new mining approach, which doesn't have the low OPEX of block caving.
And you're a big fan of copper?
I am. I am a really big fan of copper. I think, basically looking very carefully at the G20 at the moment coming up. You know, I'll be honest with you, I thought equity wise and metal wise this year would perform a lot well. I think it was at the beginning of the year. I think the whole combination of Brexit, trade war, if we can call it that, looking at the US Treasury, etc., demand, has been difficult. But demand from China, but also EV. And it heartens me that we see the majors, the copper majors, now marketing copper as the EV metal, because no matter which route you go in terms of battery technology, you're going to need copper. And the stats that we've seen from some of the copper bodies over the last year, 2 years, etc., are remarkable in terms of copper demand. And there's not a lot of supply. And that's the thing. It's a classic supply demand. Mankayan is pretty much there in terms of what it is. There's some interesting things we can do on it, but if a company wants new copper, that's the project you should be going for. Equally, Eureka, it's the other end of the scale. If you want a smaller amount of copper, but you want to have a go on something near term, then that's really interesting.
Let's stick with Eureka then. Remind us, what are the plans? What are you up to at the moment?
Well, the plans are, we're not doing anything at the moment because share price is low. We've been very careful with the money, but fundamentally, having reviewed all the data, some of our geologists absolutely love Eureka. It essentially has got previous mine at the top, lots of lower grade red bed layers, we believe, going down. So let's just say grade probably slightly above Mankayan, just for the sake of arguments. Let's just say 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, around there. But underneath, you've got these IP zones. So you've got these glowing red purple zones, probably within 200, 300 meters of surface, which we think are distinct feeder zones. So in different times, if different scenarios, you know, with all the licenses bundled up, you could probably IPO Eureka in its own right and go for some brownfields exploration drilling. Because there is copper there, because we can see it and we've got the mining results.
On Eureka, Mankayan, just remind me, what's the ownership here? Are these 100% Bezant, or are you tied up with a partner?
We have a structure in the Philippines. If you are a foreign owner, if you have an MPSA mining license, you own about 40% of the structure. Now, we have arrangements in place with the local partner where essentially we are in place, we can have 100% of the benefit, which is quite common. For instance, Medusa Mining mines and takes nearly all the benefit of production from an MPSA license. You can change to an FTA license, which is something we're thinking about, because in terms of a major group or certain types of major group wanting to own and operate a project, the conversion to MPSA to FTAA is first of all pretty much mandatory, or they want to do it. It's not mandatory from anything else other than a desire to have that in place. And secondly, it's also one of the risks in the Philippines, because the conversion's been quite slow over the last couple of years. Metals X managed to complete theirs, which is great, and they're not too far for us. So it's one of those, it's on the list, and it's a potential de-risking factor, but it's not necessarily essential. There's people who are looking at Mankayan who would be quite happy potentially to mine with an MPSA because they have a slightly different view on life.
Right. And so it's shaping up to be, you know, in the new year, moving ahead in the Philippines?
Yeah, I hope so. I hope so. I'm interested in what the engineering study says. I think that can make a real difference. These are tough markets, you know, for equities and commodities. But I think commodities are going to rebound strongly. That seems to be the consensus. Copper's the hot pick from just about everyone, which is fantastic. But we just need to see that translated into value for Bezant. But we have a copper portfolio. That's the thing now. So we're just going to be quietly progressing things, talking about what we're doing, but looking at the best value for what we can get out of this enormous amount of copper.
Laurence, thanks for your time.
Thank you.